on the topic of intellectual communities, please welcome Chair of the Department of Biomedical Informatics at Harvard Medical School, Isaac Kohane.
Good morning. First of all, I would want to wish Len a refuah shlema. I hope that he recovers very, very rapidly. So we are here today, and many of us are here today, because we're fortunate to live in an era and a time when medicine is making enormous strides in ways that affect us year by year as patients, as parents, as a species fighting disease for the past millennia. And what's making these advances, I would argue, move the fastest now is the most powerful partnership of 21st century medicine, and that is between doctors, scientists, and computing in moving forward our ability to understand how all the data works together. I don't have a clicker. Next slide. Thank you. So here you see a beautiful six-year-old child. This child was losing milestones, stopped walking, stopped talking, and stumping all the doctors that the parents brought this child to. Then this child was brought to the Undiagnosed Disease Network, a national network that comprises 12 academic, major academic medical centers. And all this patient's data, all 3 billion of his bases, all of his parents, and all the clinical data miraculously was shared to all authorized investigators across the country. And the result of coming through the millions of possible variants, which we all bear in our genome, they found the one variant that explained this disease, a mutation in GTP cyclohydrolase. This is a gene which codes for a protein which allows us to create neurotransmitters. So now, with this understanding, they gave this child neurotransmitters like L-DOPA and 5-hydroxytryptophan. This child is now walking and talking again as a result of this effort. But it's important to point out that 30% of the children and adults referred to Undiagnosed Disease Network already have genomes and exomes. They've already been looked at. What's different here is the use of this community, multidisciplinary community, bringing together computing, clinical expertise, and expertise in the technology. And at the same time, in the larger world of medicine, 250,000 people every year die from errors made in medicine. The third largest cause of death in the United States is medical errors, all preventable by the judicious use of technology and computing. So why is it that, just like the famous science fiction author William Gibson said, the future is here already, as it was for the child that I just talked about, but it's unevenly distributed? Well, I think the following may make it clearer. In Netflix, we are not surprised that Netflix knows every single movie we've ever seen. It knows also all the movies that everyone like us has seen, and in fact, worldwide. And not only that, but the owners of Netflix made available, anonymized, all their data to data scientists worldwide to come up with the best recommender algorithm to recommend what's your next movie. Contrast that with your last medical visit. How confident are you that your doctor remembered everything about your past history? How confident are you that they remembered everything about all the patients in their clinic, let alone in the world, like you? How confident are you that they made all the data from their healthcare system available to data scientists to find out what the next step is for you? I see Alex saying no. And I agree, it's very, very unlikely. but let me make this very vivid for you. This weird-looking diagram that looks like a gel electrophoresis is actually a picture of one patient showing up in the Massachusetts emergency room. And what you see on the horizontal axis is various categories of diagnosis, such as psychiatric or injuries. And this one patient, you see, has a lot. Each bar represents a diagnosis of a certain intensity. And what you see here, this patient had a lot of injuries and had a lot of GI, gastrointestinal problems. This patient, this woman, is suffering from domestic abuse. And we were able, 10 years ago, and we published this, to diagnose patients in Massachusetts, a state where you're mandated to report domestic abuse, using fairly simple artificial intelligence techniques. We were able to diagnose domestic abuse on average 2 years before the healthcare system was aware of the abuse, and up to 6 years. Why is that? There are many reasons, but chief among them is that it's very, very hard to bring innovative applications into the healthcare system to allow innovators such as those in this room to actually have impact, to bring it right into to the healthcare space. And so in 2009, just as it became clear that there was going to be a $40 billion investment by the federal government to implement electronic health records in 2009 that were state of the art for approximately 1980, we proposed that healthcare should be much more like the iPhone, that it be modular, that you should be able to bring in new applications all the time. And we proposed for this a technical solution called Smart Fire. It's an application programmer interface, which allows us to layer applications on top of the electronic health record. At the beginning, it was met with a shrug or skepticism, but I can tell you that today, if you have an iPhone and you see that little heart thing that is shown on the screen, that is from Apple Health, from hundreds of hospitals, if you've been a patient of those ones of hundreds of hospitals, a list that grows every week, you can have all your data available on that iPhone and applications such as a domestic abuse detector can actually be implemented on it. So we've actually liberated this data, and furthermore, in this million patient study funded by the NIH, the All of Us project, they're using our same interface to access data so that patients can donate their data at the national level to this study. So we really now have that data platform, and we can really start moving ahead to the more innovative stuff. So we just heard from Lori Glimcher and others really how wonderful it is that we have, for the first time in decades, we have a whole new armamentarium of drugs. And these drugs are making patients live longer. But they're living longer 1, 2, 3 years on average, if you look at the statistics. But even in those trials, and even in failed trials for cancer, there are these individuals who are miracles. They don't live 2, 3 years. They live a decade with diseases that are otherwise horrible. So what is it about these exceptional responders? What is it that allows them to live so long? So we're taking the same approach as was taken for the Undiagnosed Disease Network, that network that I was showing you at the beginning, and we're saying, can we create a system, a future, where we can actually do the same as we did for the Undiagnosed Disease Network? Now, that is a long haul, and nonetheless, we can say, you know, today, we only study a tiny fraction of our patients. Maybe 3% to 10% of all cancer patients in this country are studied in a protocol. And if we could make 50 or 80% of them studied, that would be transformative if we made it part of routine care. And certainly, we're going to have to make breakthroughs in data acquisition and machine learning to go through not only the individual tumors, but all the different heterogeneous cells within those tumors to understand what's going on. So that in the future, just as Lori or perhaps Eric said, when the patient comes in, you will be told, based on everything we know, just like Netflix does, based on everything we know about all these tumors and about all the treatments and all the responses, this is the right drug for you today. But like Len and like patients who feel the agency of urgency, we're impatient as well. And so we've started something called the Network for Enigmatic Exceptional Responders, and you see here this National Public Radio article about us, our project, where we see one of these exceptional responder patients with pancreatic cancer. And today, we're actually recruiting, and we have recruited now hundreds of individuals for whom we obtain the consent, for whom we get the immunological profile, the profile of their genome, of their cancer's genome, of their microbiome, of their Fitbit, of their lifestyle and their beliefs, and using that as grist for computation, machine learning, to figure out what is the common thread or common threads that predict an exceptional response. So that, in fact, in 2030, we'll be able to exactly get to the vision that you've just heard about. And I do want to now close by saying that essential to this is someone that we haven't talked, I think, enough about. There is a community of patients, of doctors, of investigators, of industry, but I think what data science and computation will enable is to bring into the community patients as drivers, not only as consenters for use of data, but as direct beneficiaries of the research, and as direct controllers of who and when their data is obtained. So I want to thank, again, Len and the Blavatnik Foundation for their gift, and I look forward to working with them over the next years to realize this shared vision for our shared community. Thank you very much.